We're going to begin talking about the offerings. And the offerings are, we just talked about the Passover, and with the Passover there are specific offerings. And then what we did was we looked in the New Testament and we saw that it was more than just historical information about a Jewish nation. But that it has actual meaning to us. And if we don't know what that meaning is, then we are not living in the fulfillment of the new covenant, but rather we are living randomly in a religious culture that has presented itself apart from Jesus being the fulfillment of something instead of Jesus just doing away with something. And we saw that the scriptures are speaking to us. And they are speaking to Gentiles, and they are speaking to people about Passover, about offerings, all of this in light of Christ as our life, not just in light of a historical event. 2,000 years ago, Jesus did so and so, more than that, much more than that. And it is the reality of Christ that fulfills anything. He is the fulfillment, but he is also the fulfiller of all things. And so in the book of Leviticus chapter 1, actually if you went through Leviticus, you'd go all the way to chapter 6, where you'd go all the way to chapter 8, the end of chapter 7, where you would be discovering the main offerings. Now, when I say the main offerings, there are specific offerings for Passover, things like that. But there are two categories of offerings in the book of Leviticus and in the Bible, in the Old Covenant. And most Christians, when they relate to the Lord, they only relate based on one category. Those two categories are, according to Leviticus 1 through 7, are sweet savor offerings and sin offerings. Now, most Christians are well familiar with with sin offerings. They think that when Jesus died on the cross, all he did was fulfilled being a sin offering. But Jesus fulfilled all the offerings. It wasn't just about sin. And that's why people don't really comprehend the bride. For example, Ephesians 5, where the scripture says of Jesus that he gave himself that he might have a bride. Well, that's not giving yourself for sin. That's giving yourself for something. And it has nothing, ultimately, you have to deal with sinners' sin. But then she is to be made a bride. And to do that also brought about his death. And so in Leviticus chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, it's real well laid out here the way they divided it. Chapter 1 through 3 are the sweet savor offerings. And the three sweet savor offerings are the burnt offering, which is chapter 1. Chapter 2 is the meal offering or meat offering. And then chapter 3 is the peace offering. Once you get to chapter 4, you get into the sin offerings, the non-sweet savor offerings. The sin offering is chapter 4, and yes, then chapter 5 is the trespass offering. And then chapter 6 is still part of the trespass offering down to verse 8. And verse 8 starts again with the burnt offering, verse 14 with the meal offering, verse 24 with the sin offering. And so the first couple of chapters there really outline it well for you to comprehend the difference. So there are two categories, sin offerings and sweet savor offerings. In the sin offerings, there are two categories, and that is what's called a sin offering and what's called a trespass offering. Most Christians, again, have moved that down, and they're not even fully aware of the trespass offering. They are aware of if you commit sin, you go to Jesus and you ask for forgiveness. But Jesus had a lot to say about trespassing against people. A trespass is something that you do against somebody. Now, you may not have sinned in what you did against them, but if they become offended, then there's a trespass. And it has nothing to do with actual legal sin. It has to do with offending somebody. And so Jesus said, if you go to the altar and your brother has aught with you, leave your gift on the altar and go back and say, this is new covenant relations now. This isn't just, we don't have an altar out here. We don't have a thing where we're offering up goats and bulls and stuff like that. We're supposed to be living this. We're supposed to be the fulfillment and the living reality, the new covenant, not going through the motions of that. Well, so there's this whole area of that makes up the major portion of the Christian's life in relationship to trespass offerings. All right. But that's not, we're not going to talk about that so much. That was just sort of a little introduction to help you realize that in all of the offerings of Israel, there are just two main categories, sin offerings and sweet savor offerings. And there are more sweet savor offerings, meaning offerings which we'll get into their full meaning, but a sweet savor offering is something given by somebody whose sins are already removed and they were removed. They've already had a sin offering. Their sins are already removed and they're walking under the blood. They're walking in grace. They're living by grace. So the sweet savor offerings are for someone who is in right relationship with the Lord. It has nothing to do with you doing wrong. It has nothing to do with guilt. Well, the biblical picture has nothing to do with guilt. I fear that many Christians do a lot of sweet savor offerings because of guilt. But the biblical picture is not one of guilt. It's not one of sin or failure. It has to do with someone who is right with the Lord, and that's not enough for them. They're not okay just to say, okay, I'm not going to hell. I'm not going to be punished today for anything because I haven't done anything wrong, because either my sin is covered by the blood of Jesus or I've been doing good. You see what I'm saying? But it has, the sweet savor offerings are for someone, for example, we've used this recently, the 10 lepers when Jesus healed them. 9 of them got their healing, or 10 of them got their healing. 9 of them said, that's it. I got what I wanted from the Lord. 1 of them returned back and gave a thank offering. 1 of them felt that this was not just enough that I have what I got from Jesus and everything's okay now and my life's good. Now I'm going to just leave Jesus and go live my own life and live it healed. I'm healed. I'm better. I'm me. I'm the center. I'm the focus. But rather, no, Jesus is the center. Jesus is the focus. Jesus is the fountain. Jesus is the source. Jesus is the one. And, well, we can sort of read a couple of things in Leviticus 1 here. In Leviticus 1, verse 3, it says, if his offering be a burnt sacrifice of the herd, let him offer a male without blemish. He shall offer it of his own voluntary will at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation before the Lord. Before the Lord. This isn't just something you do in passing as you go about your way. Not only that, but it is, notice it says, he shall offer it of his own voluntary will. This is, the sin offerings were required. If you sinned, you better bring a sin offering. If you've sinned, you better bring the blood of Jesus before the Father. If you've sinned, you are required by law to come to God through sacrifice. Okay. But this has nothing to do with requirements. This is something voluntary. This is something you have to find in your own heart. If it's not there, it's just not there. I mean, that's just the way it is. If it's not there, it's not there. Now, this is where people get jealous or look down on certain people, you know. Well, Sister so-and-so, I mean, she always seems so spiritual. She's always after the Lord. She always has a heart for God. She always, you know, Brother so-and-so always seems to be in the Word. He's always, you know, da-da-da-da. And there's sort of a put-down with that because, frankly, a lot of times we don't find those things in our own heart. It's not like we just keep driving toward Jesus. It's not like, I haven't given enough. I haven't done enough. I mean, I haven't honored him enough. I love him more than even what I'm doing now. I must pour out, you know, like the woman with the alabaster box. You know, her own brother, Lazarus, had just died shortly before that. And she didn't take the alabaster box and go empty it on Lazarus's feet, her brother. But she did on Jesus's. She poured it out on Jesus's feet. Why? Judas was there. Judas was watching. And Judas got upset and he said, why are you wasting this? That's what he called it. He called it a waste. Because he only understood sin offerings. Well, if you do something wrong, man, whatever it takes. But if you're in good graces, man, why would you give up anything extra? Why would you lose, you know, I mean, at a sin offering, if you go to the altar and you come for because of a sin, what you give up is your sin. What you give up is your guilt. What you give up is your punishment that is due you. You're giving up all bad stuff to Jesus. Am I right? If you come to Jesus over a sin, you're giving up all the bad stuff that's going to happen to you. Your guilt, your punishment, all this kind of stuff. But the woman with the alabaster box, she gave up her good stuff. Not just her good stuff, she gave up her best. The Bible says it was costly. It was costly to her. Well, what's going to elicit a sweet savor offering? No law, no requirement, no demand. It's just going to be from the heart. It's going to be what is found there in the heart. And it's not called a sin offering. Did you know a sin offering is not a sweet savor in the nostrils of God? But did you know that's the name of the sweet savor offerings? It is a giving of what you love. It is a giving of your best. It is a giving from the heart. It is, I'm going to say it like this. It is sweet loss. Sweet loss. Well, you can't talk to any self-respecting, Adamic, humanized flesh person and talk about sweet loss because he doesn't want to, everything, you know, you start talking about deny yourself, take up your cross, well, forget that. You know, I don't want to do that. I've got a life. I've got a future. You know, but what kind of a future is it without Jesus, and not just Jesus as Savior. Savior meaning sin offering. Am I right or wrong? When we say Savior, we are talking about Jesus as the sin offering. You know, even when we say sweet Savior, he's so sweet because he saved us. He's so sweet because I'm not going to hell. He's so sweet because, you know, you see what I'm saying? The term Savior is primarily a term applied to a sin offering. But the bride of Christ, but the sons of God to the Father, but and that's what, you know, John, I mean, you read John's writings, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. This is the guy described in the gospel as the disciple whom Jesus loved. He says, beloved, he's talking to, he doesn't say, sinners, rank failures, be glad because you're saved from hell. You know what he says? Beloved, now are we the sons of God, not saved sinners. Now are we the sons of God, and it doth not fully manifest what we shall be, but when he appears, there's what we were meant to manifest, him. And everyone that has this hope purifies himself, even as he is already pure, because we're manifesting the oneness. Because we're manifesting the oneness, not just believing in it. We are embracing it. Yes, there has to be faith. But faith eventually brings forth, let's just say, life and living reality. Well, we talked about this last class, but a sweet savor offering, since it is not required, it is like Paul describing in Philippians 2 when he says, I count all things loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, by whom I count all things but dung, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable to his death. He's describing a desire within himself to come into conformity to his death. He's claiming he hadn't got it yet. He's claiming he wants the power. Not resurrection power. That doesn't say resurrection power. It says the power of his resurrection. That's his life coming forth in his body. The fellowship of his sufferings. He's praying for that. He's seeking that. And he's counting it all loss before he even has it, before Christ is revealed in him, before the cross is at work in him, before the resurrection has taken place in him. He's counting it all loss. Where does that come from? I mean, where does that come from in a person? It doesn't come from Christ within. It comes from a heart that wants the Lord to that degree, to enter into the cross, be conformed to it. I mean, you know, I mean, most Christians are wanting to be conformed to, you know, Jesus that walked in power. Paul said, I want to be made conformable to his death. But Paul, when he wrote that, he wasn't there yet. He was still seeking the revelation of it, how he described the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, by whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count it but dung. You know what the word dung is? It's the word, never mind, but you know what it is. It describes what we hold on to. Because he said there, the things that were gained to me, I count loss. He didn't say the thing that's junk, I give up. I give up my sin, my smoking, my lying, my stealing, my... That wouldn't be a sweet savor to God. To just give God, you know, it's like God sitting there and you say, okay, here's my pack of cigarettes, you know, like God's going to take it and go, wow, thanks. I can use these. This is a sweet savor, you know. This alcohol is too. This is great. Thanks, you know. I mean, you know, that's ridiculous. And yet when we do it, we go, oh, I'm so holy. I'm really blessing God right now, you know. No. It's when sin is no longer an issue. It's when those things are dealt with when you're walking in grace, that it comes into your heart and you, like Paul said, you know what? Man, just to be one with him, just to walk in reality with him, to find, you know, I mean, can you imagine where a thank offering comes from? Can you imagine where a peace offering comes from? From incredible peace, where the two were at odds, and now the two are one. There's peace in that. There's peace, you know. The reason why you can't get along with some people is because there's two of you. There's you, and then there's them. That's where, you know, I mean, you get along with yourself pretty good. You like the same things. You like the same kind of movies. You like the same kind of food. You get along real well, you know. So, well, let's see, what am I going to order? You don't go, well, no, order this, no, that. Now, some of you do, because you get it in your mind of the American culture that you're supposed to be on a diet. So you go. So you do have two people. It's one is the American culture and the other one's you. All right, so let's just look at a scripture in the New Testament. Turn with me to Ephesians. Now, I mentioned this verse, so let's look at it real quick. It's Ephesians 5. And this is verse 25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Now, I'll never forget when God revealed that verse to me. It was an eye-opener of incredible magnitude when I realized this said Jesus gave himself not for sinners. This says he's given himself for a bride. Okay, that's not death for what's wrong. That's death for what's right. Right? I mean, that's not just, you know, and Jesus loved, and there are scriptures that plainly declare Jesus loves the sinner and gave himself for it. Can I get amen on that? You know, we all know that. But this isn't talking about that. This is talking about, because we're now the bride of Christ. You know, Jesus, a sin offering, okay, help me out here. If a person went in Israel, you know, 2,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, if they went and offered a sin offering to God, did that magically turn them into the bride of Christ? No. They were a forgiven, rank sinner. They were a bad person whose sins were covered and who would sin again. See? And you will too, as long as you keep it on the sin offering. You will. You'll just keep offering and offering, or going to the offering that is settled, you know. But Jesus wanted not just to forgive us, but to transform us. There is a difference. Can I get an amen on that? I mean, you know, come on. Let's break, you know, let's take a baseball bat and break out of the carnal view of this thing and start realizing, start considering. Transformation is an incredible word in light of modern day Christianity, which is pretty much untransformed. Transformation, is it a possibility? Could it happen? Where it manifests? You better believe it. You better believe it. The Bible is full of the promise of that. Well, I just mentioned this scripture, but guess where this scripture came from? This is the middle and ending of chapter 5. Let's start at the beginning of chapter 5. Ephesians 5:1. Be ye therefore followers of God as dear children, and walk in love. All right. Now, what did it say? Husbands, love your wife. All right. Now, in Israel, under the old covenant, you didn't have to love God to offer a sin offering. You could just fear God. Right? You didn't even have to fear God. You just fear punishment. I mean, there. You know, I mean, it gets right down to, let's just slash this to the bone. You know, I fear punishment. You know, you don't even really fear and respect God. You just fear hell, you know. You feel the flames lapping up around you and pulling you down, you know. I don't want that. So Jesus is, you take out fire insurance. That's what Jesus is. He's your agent. Well, this says walk in love. This says husbands love. We'll see another scripture that shows this in just a second, but look at this. And walk in love as Christ also loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. That's not talking about a sin offering there. That giving of himself right there, look at it. It's clear, it's clear cut, and it's totally in line with the old covenant fulfillment of sweet savor offering. He loved us and he gave himself for us as a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor, so that he could bring us out of us. No, that's part of it. Only the beginning. So he could bring us into himself. In other words, not just bring us out of Egypt, bring us into the promised land. It's a big leap. It's a big reality there. And so here we have another New Testament scripture that's telling us that the Old Testament is fulfilled not 2,000 years ago by just a work of Jesus, but by a reality that we are walking in now. We're walking in the love of that thing, not the requirement of it. Well, let's look at another scripture then, over in Matthew. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 12. So let me just say it like this. The sweet savor offerings are not offered because of sin or because of failure. They're offered because of love. And that's where we get husbands, love your wife, as Christ loved the church and gave himself. Walk in love, brothers. Forget marriage now. Walk in love, brothers and sisters, according to that same sweet savor of Christ who gave himself. Well, how did he do that? He gave himself for everyone. But he gave himself to bring us not just out of hell, not just out of sin, not just out of punishment, not just out of guilt, not just out of condemnation, but into relationship of oneness that is, will be eternal and forever settled. It is eternal and forever settled in his heart. Just the problem is, The problem is that we haven't found the love that he has for us. We haven't found that same love for him yet. We haven't discovered that. Look in Matthew 12. Let's see, verse 32, I think it is. Hope I'm in the right place here. Oh, gosh. See, I was thinking I knew where this scripture was, so let's see if I can discover it real quick. Well, the scripture is the one. I thought it was in Matthew 12:32, but it's the one where it's probably right here. Jesus says to him, basically, or they said, "What is the greatest commandment?" Maybe it's 11. Nope. It's probably right here in front of my eyes, and I'm just not seeing it. Or maybe it's out of Mark. Do y'all know which one I'm talking about, though? Check If anyone would, check Mark or some of that also for me. And I'll go ahead and tell the story just in case we don't find it here.
Matthew 22
sounds right. Yeah, it sounds. I think it was further on. Now that I 22. Yes. Now, I'm not sure if this is the exact one. Let's see. It's all. Oh, you know what? It is in Mark 12. Keep your place there just in case Mark 12 isn't it. See, isn't this fun, searching the scriptures together? That's because you got an idiot for a teacher. Okay, Mark 12, 28. Thank you. That's why the inmates run the asylum around here. Mark 12, 28. And one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answered, the first of all commandments is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. See, I love this. I could just go off on this right now. I mean, he says, what's the greatest commandment? And he doesn't say, love the Lord thy God with all your heart. He says, here's the greatest commandment. Hear, O Israel. If you don't hear it, it doesn't do any good. You can, you know, people can, did you know people talk to you all the time and you don't hear what they're saying?
Yeah.
You know, it is happening right now. There are people, that's where actually why I said it, but that's another story. He says, this is the first commandment. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one. You're not going to love until the true love, I'm just going to tell you this. I don't know how much it'll mean to you. True love is oneness. In fact, you'll discover more what love is by studying oneness than you will discover what oneness is by studying love, for most part, because we're too clouded over what we think love is. Hear, O Israel, this is the first commandment. The Lord thy God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is this. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is no other commandment greater than these. And the scribe said unto him, well, master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is no other but he. Now get this. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the soul. I mean, I'm getting goosebumps from just comprehending his heart here. With all the soul. What? With all the soul. And with all the strength, to love his neighbor as himself is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. That's the fulfillment of all of the sweet savor offerings. You want to know how I know that? Because Jesus then says, and when Jesus saw that he answered discreetly, he said unto him, thou art not far from the kingdom of God. And no man after that dared to ask him, any question, because they were questioning him and pressing him and trying to disprove him, and all of a sudden somebody in the crowd gets hold of the truth, and Jesus said, now we're on the right track. And they're going, well, if that's the right track, I'm not even sure I understand it. And yet Jesus shut down all of the scribes and all of the Pharisees and all of the Sadducees. And of course they were Sadducee after that, because they couldn't question him anymore. But, you know, Jesus shuts him down. But really, it wasn't just him. It was this one who said, let me tell you. And he didn't mince anywhere. He went ahead and said the whole thing, all your heart. So, you know, to love the Lord thy God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and with all your might. He's saying, this is it. This is better than all whole burnt offerings, because we'll get in to see that. That's one of the sweet savor offerings. That was burned in the morning, at night, all day long, every day, all the time. Folks, there wasn't a sin offering burning all the time. But there was supposed to be this whole burnt offering of loving the Lord thy God. Not, you know, I mean, I've talked to people and they say, I say, well, the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God. And they say, well, I'm seeking the kingdom of God. I've been seeking the kingdom of God my whole Christian life. I said, but are you seeking it first? Well, no, I guess it's not first. Well, then forget it. You're not following through with the not the requirement, not the commandment, the spirit of the thing. The spirit of the thing isn't just to be a Christian. The spirit of the thing isn't just to go through the motions. And, I'll just tell you right now, don't go through the motions. Come on, don't do it. Don't go through the motions. And you say, well, okay, I won't go through the motions. I'll just be a bad person in the church. Then you're going through the motions still. Go be a good person in the bar. What I mean is one that drinks and cusses and has a good time and, this is the way I feel. I mean, honestly, if I didn't feel that my heart wasn't continuing after the Lord with all my heart, I would just go out and I'd be the best sinner I could possibly be. I would bust hell wide open. At least I'd have a few memories while I'm there. Well, baby, you remember the time you and me, The devil goes, yeah, that was good. he and I'd be sitting over there, crowd listening to what we used to do together. I mean, if I'm not going to go all out for Jesus, my God, I might as well just have a good time and just be able to tell some stories and have some memories of something instead of being miserable and faking it and half-hearted and lukewarm and fence riding and backslidden and not in, not out. My God, go, first gear, second gear, third gear. It's like some people's Christian vehicle only has like one gear, first gear. I'm trying to go faster, and they can get it going, but they're still just barely creeping. You're going to blow your engine, for God's sake. You ask your car when you're going in first gear, you put it in second, goes, oh, thank God. You're on third gear, oh, praise the Lord. If you got fifth gear, whoa, Yeah, and now he's free, and it feels free, and your car's happy and everything. But God, it's frustrating to that Christian vehicle. Sliding around in first gear, and then, and wondering, you're at a race, here you are, Indy 500, run, 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 and they're off, and dust everywhere, and you're going, barely moving, and he's sort of off. The announcer finally, after 5 minutes, you've only moved a few feet, and he's still standing there, goes, ladies and gentlemen, shut down your engine. My God. You're going to blow a rod. You're going to throw a rod, man. Well, okay. But let's consider, okay, now let's patch this up a little bit here with this thought. Okay, yes, you can be totally forgiven of sin. You can only focus in on the sin offering, and you can be forgiven of sin and go to church and not ever hit fifth gear or fourth or third. You can do that. But that's not the Lord's plan. That's not his heart. If it was his heart, then there only would have been sin offerings. But he gave the option for sweet, savor offerings to be given to him. And this guy, and that's why Jesus said to this guy, whoever he is, my God, he was a scribe, He was a scribe, Jesus said, man, you're just not far from the government of God. The government of God. Christ governing through us. That's what it is. He's not just saying, well, you keep going, you'll get in the kingdom or something. That's not what he's saying. He's saying, my God, you're on the right trail to the actual government of God, the kingdom of God, the rule of Christ within you. To love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, and strength. And, you know, Jesus made a little different. I mean, in the old covenant, it was love your neighbor as yourself. In the new covenant, it was love your enemies as, you know, love your neighbor and love your enemies. And not just as yourself, but as I have loved, which is more than you would have loved yourself, which is a lot. But it's not near what he loves. No matter how much we love ourselves, Jesus loves the ungodly, the enemies, even more. Well, that's going to require transformation, not just forgiveness. You know, somebody can do something wrong and you can forgive them and they're still the same old lousy person. Can I get amen? They're just forgiven for what they did, you know? I mean, if somebody, let's just say, you ever heard of what a kleptomaniac is? Yeah, somebody who steals all the time, and they just have a tendency towards stealing, and it's just their deal, you know what I mean? They shoplift, or they do this, or whatever, but it's not just shoplifting, it's, you know, they spend the night at your house, and you check your closet the next morning, and clothes are missing, stuff like that, you know. And so let's say that happened. Let's say they spent the night at your house, and then, you know, like 2 months later, you see them wearing your clothes. Okay. Yeah, that would be. So you come up, and you go, my God, I've been missing that for 2 months. In fact, it disappeared the very night you stayed over at my house. Okay, I admit it. I don't know what's wrong with me. I'm a kleptomaniac, man. I just, this tendency comes on me. I just feel like stealing, and I saw this Babylonish garment, and I took it. Well, since I'm a Christian, I forgive you. Okay, well, that's good. They're forgiven. But they're still a kleptomaniac. Don't let them in your house again. I mean, would that be the normal way of thinking? Well, folks, there's more to it than that. There, we'll never get to the sweet savor offerings unless we're transformed on the inside. Unless Christ is formed in us, then it's just us. I mean, what if Christianity was just us? Yeah, and does that discourage anybody? What if Christianity was just us and we're just trying harder than the rest? We're the Avis rent-a-car of the, of Christianity. We're just all trying harder. But it's still just us. Well, thank God, you know. I mean, at least there's not as much stealing and stuff like that. Well, it's not, but I mean, we're still what we are, and it comes out in certain ways. Did you know that? That kleptomaniac will say, or an alcoholic will say, okay, I'm not going to drink here, I'm not going to drink here, I'm not going to drink here, and then break down and drink and binge here. You know, for example, my stepfather, my mother and my stepfather were alcoholics. They never binged because they just drank all the time. I didn't even know my stepfather was a drunk till I saw him sober once. Well, looky there. I couldn't even imagine. When you're just consistent, you don't have to binge. You just drunk all the time. Am I right or wrong? Come on. I'll tell you when you need to binge, when you keep trying to stop. You know. I had a friend. We were good friends in high school, and we knew we shouldn't smoke, but we both smoked, and And we kept, we said, okay, we're going to stop. We can do this if two of us do it together, you know. And so, you know, we throw our cigarettes in the toilet and we flush it down there. That's it. We're not going to smoke anymore. And we, you know, go one day and a half. He comes pulling up that night in the car, and I can see smoke coming out. I mean, it looks like a freight train inside the car, the smoke coming out. The guy's got two cigarettes going, and one, I mean, he's just like this. I said, what are you doing? He says, I'm out. I'm out, you know. And I said, well, you know, then why are you smoking all these? I've got to make up for the last 2 days. I said, what do you mean? Well, my body's craving it. I got to have it. So, you know, and so I learned from then. I have a saying that I use ever since then. When someone who doesn't quit by Christ, when they're just trying to stop, they come and tell me, hey, I quit smoking today. I go, you didn't quit. You just stopped for a while. Because if it's them, they will eventually go back and binge and get on the whatever it is, whatever that thing is. Does anybody see why us preaching Christ in you as the hope of glory would be important? Does anybody see why? You know, I've had people say, oh, my God, Randy, all you talk about is Jesus. You know, like that's offensive. You know, I mean, I'm not talking about rape or something, you know. I'm talking about Jesus, you know. I mean, we should go, well, thank God he talks about Jesus, you know. But no, you know, all you do is talk about Jesus and everything. But I'll tell you why, because I believe that our only hope is Christ. There is no hope in us. And the sooner we really learn that, what's going to happen? The less discouraged we're going to be about ourselves. Because we'll go, you know what? That's me. Christ hadn't been formed in me there. I need Jesus. I need Christ formed in me. When I was in Bible school and I started seeing this, I went up to everybody. I mean, I drove people crazy. I went up to people and I said, you know, man, I need Jesus. Would you pray for me? I'd do something wrong or take something or do something in the Bible school, you know, and somebody come up to me and go, hey, man, that was my book, or that was, you know, da-da-da-da, this or that. And I just say, would you just pray for me right now, you know, instead of going. I mean, I did that all the time after a while. At first, it was self-justification, but after a while, I just went, I did it because I saw that it wasn't Jesus in me, and the only hope was Jesus. So I'd go, well, I would just literally drop, bow my head just like this and go, would you just pray for me right now? Pray that Christ be formed in me, would you? And, you know, I had a reputation there for a while to be the flunky because I was always at the altar. I was always asking for prayer. But I was one of the few that ended up really seeing Jesus in the scriptures ultimately. You know, same people that thought I was the flunky voted me in as president of the student council because they wanted something of the Lord to be brought. But it took a while, and it took a long time of me saying, you know what, I will never, you know, Jesus said that. Don't try to patch up an old garment. It's going to just tear around the edges, and then you make the whole thing worse, you know. The holes that people see in your life get bigger. Stop it. But here's the deal. See, it's not stop faking it. It's get serious about getting hold of God. It's do business with God. It's get into contract with God. Get into covenant with God. And say, man, I need you, Jesus. I know the answer. You're the answer. If you went to any church in America, except for a few, but most of them, if you went to any church and you said, what's the answer? Every one of them would say, Jesus. Am I right or wrong? Any church, what's the answer? Jesus. What are you looking to for the answer? Me. My strength, my commitment. You know? I'm not the answer. You're not the answer. You know, another thing around here is just, not just here, but everywhere. Sooner or later, some leader is going to fail you. know, I heard about Amber's little talk today. Someday, sooner or later, some leader's going to fail you. And you're going to just love tearing them down. Well, you failed. You did this wrong. You know. How about just praying for them that they get Jesus too? How about a sweet savor offering? One that fulfills all whole burnt offering. Now, see, we don't understand what that means when he said that. When he says, and to love his neighbor as himself is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. I want you to remember that phrase, because sooner or later, maybe even the next class, we may get into some of the scriptures that show how many burnt offerings that these people were offering all the time. Because it wasn't just the evening and the morning sacrifice. They were constantly giving burnt offerings and everything for other things too. Constantly. We'll see what that means in a little bit. All right, so love is the fulfillment of the whole burnt offering. To walk in love, to walk in oneness, to walk in that reality. And another scripture in the New Testament, 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2. We looked at this scripture in the, what does it mean to be a New Testament priest class, course, and this is 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a people of his own, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now, if you read that in the King James, that's what it says. It says to show forth his praises. Some of your Bibles is going to have a marginal note on the word praises there. I don't know. Some of you may not have a marginal Bible, but I notice that some of you do. And in the margin, it's going to say, for the word praises is not praises, but excellencies. You're not going to show forth his praises. You're going to show forth his excellencies, his virtues. That's literally what that means. Now, remember in that priesthood class, we talked about David's tabernacle, and yes, there was a truth that David set up praisers and worshipers. But wouldn't it be funny if that was only the shadow? I mean, wouldn't it be funny if instead of setting up 24-hour praise services and copying the shadow. Think about that. I mean, there are churches, I'm just saying that because there are churches who claim to be David's tabernacle, and they have set it up where somebody comes in and they're worshiping. They've got a worship service going on, you know, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you know. But basically they're copying the old covenant. They're copying the shadow. What if instead of, because back then they didn't have Christ formed in them. So what if they couldn't show forth Christ in his virtues, his excellency, his long suffering, his forgiveness, his going the second mile? What if they couldn't do that? So the shadow was set up that they did it by praises, but that was only a shadow of what it meant, where we're the temple, and in the temple 24 hours a day, we're showing forth the excellencies of Christ's virtue and natures through us, the temple of God. What if that's the actual fulfillment of this shadow? Instead of copying the shadow, we've found the marvelous light. Isn't that what it says right here? show forth his excellencies, who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Not just into marvelous light. I mean, it really is different, isn't it? Just, I mean, you take the word his out of it, and it's just it's random light on new religion or new things. But when it's his marvelous light, we are not, because in fact, I didn't even finish reading it there in Ephesians, but it goes on to say, for you who were sometime darkness, now are you light in the Lord. I'm going to do that. We're going to go back to Ephesians 5 and just read this. Can you handle it? All right, here we go. Fasten your seatbelt. Ephesians 5:2, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sweet savor to God for a sweet, or a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, what is covetousness? You could translate it, I want it justness. I want it justness. I want that. I want this. Fornication, well, you know what that is. Let it not be once named among you as becometh saints, neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. There's the sweet savor. For this ye know, that no fornicator, nor unclean person, nor covetous man, who is an idolater, meaning he, I wrote a thing on this. I don't know if I ever put it in my newsletter on idolatry. Did I ever do that? I need to do that sometime to show what true idolatry is, which is covetousness. Paul tells us true idolatry is covetousness. In the Old Testament, it was a shadow to sit before a idol. That was called idolatry, but that was a shadow. In the New Testament, it is idolizing people and things. I remember, like nowadays, if you wear a shirt that says, you know, like a shirt says Coca-Cola, or you have a hat that says Nike or something like that. Well, when I was in high school, they would give those things away for free. We wouldn't wear it. I remember saying, I ain't going to give them free advertising. What is the deal? They pay me, you know, $100 a month. I'll do it. You know? But something happened where they got into the psyche of Americans and they said, you're something special if it says, you know, Calvin Klein or, you know, you know what I'm saying. And so all of a sudden, it's cool to wear, to advertise for them for free. Just like, you know, you read about the bottled water thing, the Aquafina. It's tap water. Did you know that? It's tap water. It is tap water. It's not, I'm not saying that. It's tap water. It's the most popular drink, bottled water in America. It's tap water. Ooh, this tastes good. Ooh, this is healthy. Oh, this is pure. Oh, no, it's not. And so they've actually got a little thing, it's initials, and I forget, won't even come close, but it's like SBC or something, but it's saying this is tap water, but it only puts the one letter of each word, and they said now they're going to have to go back because they've been exposed and say this actually... But they won't say this is tap water. They'll say this comes from a public source. This comes from a they'll do something like that, you know. So everybody's paying a buck a thing, you know. It's good stuff, you know. There, you know, we're all just suckered in. We're just cattle. We're just cattle mooing along. Ooh, ooh, you know, and they wave something over here. Ooh, look over there. You know, and we head off over there, you know. Well, by the way, no offense about your Nike hat. I'm just trying to make a... we've all done it, so it's... Yeah. There you go. As long as it keeps the Texas sun off your head, you're good. But my point, you know, I was talking about idolatry. We're going to have to quit here, and I'm not going to be able to finish this. But covetousness, idolatry is the actual covetousness. Is the actual, or covetousness is the actual idolatry. Because there are no real idols in that sense other than, you know, American idols. And such, you know. American Idol inventors, American Idol, you know, impersonators, American Idol pirates. I don't know. But it's just going nuts. All right, well, I just felt like I ought to go ahead and just read this just to see if anybody gets uncomfortable. Verse 5, for this ye know, that no fornicator, nor unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the sons, well, at least there are the children, yours says, but it's the original sons of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them, for ye were once, and that's really the word, sometimes there is the actual word, once darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Okay, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth. Folks, all this is saying is, you turn you over to you and you're going to be a mess. You're going to do this stuff. And you can say, thank God there's a sin offering that takes my sins away. But God isn't just wanting to forgive your sins for the things listed here. He's wanting to change you and bring forth the because he said it. You were once darkness, not you were in darkness, you were the darkness. He's the light. And now you're light in union, because the word in means in union. Now you are light. Not in yourself, in union with the Lord. Walk, therefore, as children of the light. And the fruit is all, you know, this is the fruit of the Spirit, and the love, joy, peace, gentleness, meekness, piety. You know, it's all of that stuff that works by life, but it's his life. Well, somewhere we've got to not hate sin, but hate ourselves and want Jesus. When I say hate ourselves, you understand what I mean. Hate the life that fails God. Hate the life that can never live up to the standards of God. Jesus said it, and I'm trying to close out here, but Jesus said, the Old Testament said, you know, Jesus said, the Old Testament said, thou shalt not commit sin, but I say unto you, if anybody does this, his requirements are stricter. Why? I thought if Jesus came, he was going to make it better. Why is his stricter? They're not stricter. It is his life that fulfills even the second mile requirement. It's not... I mean, even if it was stricter, it's easier because he gives us the life and nature to do it, not just the commandment and the regulation and the rule to do it. Does that make sense?
Amen.
I mean, yeah. So with that, we're going to quit. Take a break.